Today is the last Sunday for Reverend Claudia to be with us. She is moving to Blairsville, Georgia. She's going to be a great blessing to the community, and we wanted to just offer a round of applause. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And we know that something amazing is yet to unfold in your life as you begin this new chapter. And we know that you're going to be an amazing light of love and presence to those people of the Blairsville community and the church there. We're just delighted to have known you and have experienced your ministry and know that just we send you with lots of love and the very thought that you can always come back home. So we'd love to have you back. And so we think the church that's alive is worth the drive, and 2 hours is not a big deal, right? You can drive to church on Sunday morning. Just get them early and come on in. We'd love to see you. Well, how many of you are familiar with some of the great comedians of our time? Carol Burnett, everybody remember her? Lucille Ball, oh, I love Lucy, right? How about some of those great comedians of SNL, Saturday Night Live? Don't we see some of those? Tina Fey and many others who just make us laugh with their great character portrayals. And so it is. And even how about up here? Is this Pee Wee Herman? Mr. Bean, oh yes, I'm sorry. There we go. How to make an entrance is what we're talking about today. Because these great actors, these great comedians, knew how to make an entrance. It was very crucial because it expressed their motivation. It was crucial to the storyline of the skit or the play. That when they made an entrance, they projected exactly what they desired the character to say to show to the audience. Their motivation and their very intention was founded. It's how they thought about that entrance. Well, today, Jesus, our way shower, our great teacher, teaches us how to make an entrance. And let's look at exactly what the writer of this text that you read earlier and also found on the back of your bulletin says. It's called a triumphal entry. What does the writer want to convey to us? What was Jesus trying to share with us? What was he trying to teach? For the triumphal entrance into Jerusalem is not just Jesus' entrance, it's our entrance as well. It's how we enter every day of living. It's a metaphor. It's symbolically presented to us. It's a teaching to say, this is how you walk into life. This is how you enter every occasion. This is how you make an entrance. This is how it's done. It's not just how we arrive at a party or how we live, arrive at work. It's about this entrance for everyday living of our lives. It's so much more than the story of Jesus visiting Jerusalem or people waving palm branches or throwing down their coats. There's so much more than this just being an entrance into a city. It's more than just the beginning of a week. It's telling us something specific about our lives and how we might make the entrances. It's truly a lesson in life. You see, this world wanted to stop Jesus. And that's the very setting. It began to raise opposition to everything that Jesus taught and everything that Jesus stood for. For his teaching of people having a personal power began to rattle the cages of religious leaders of that time. What? You have a personal power? No. The only power is Rome in its occupation. No. The only power is those who are religious leaders of the day. No, you don't have a personal power. Yet Jesus began to teach about that, about the divine presence, the Spirit of God within you, of a God dwelling within, not far off and separated from humanity, that each of us has a power to create change and bring about transformation. Well, that was earth-shattering in its own. What did the people who were in rule and in power want? They didn't want people making change. They didn't want people bringing about transformation. Everything that Jesus began to talk about from a spiritual realm was so radical for that time and for their understanding. They wanted to see this was the end of his teaching. So, of course, the disciples warned Jesus, I wouldn't go into Jerusalem at this time. I wouldn't be thinking about this. You know, it's not necessarily the most positive environment for you. It's not going to be the most welcoming context for you. Yet he knew that he had a purpose. He knew that he had a message. And how he entered into the city would convey something for all of time, for us all to understand. He was not just coming into a place where the people wanted to come and hear him. He was coming with a divine message. He was coming with an intention in his heart. For this place was not a welcoming place for that metaphysical teaching of Jesus. That very teaching that was inviting everyone to look beyond the physical and see the spiritual. This past week, I had a wonderful time to share with the student volunteers. And so many of them, the young people, were questioning, as young people do today, spirituality. Several of them said, you know, I used to go to church, but I want to tell you honestly, Pastor, I'm an atheist. I'm not a real believer anymore. And as they began to unfold, I said, tell me about your beliefs. Well, you know, everything around the physical world, wait. Let me invite you to see the world of the spiritual. Change your outlook. Change your look, because we've been so attached to seeing everything falling and coming into place to how it has to manifest through the physical, when the spiritual is what Jesus invited you to live in. That there's more than just a life on this earth. It's a life that we're living through all time. That Jesus spoke of an eternal life that's ongoing. About living in the wonderful power of spirituality. Even though the world around us may have its physical limitations, we know that in the spiritual realm there are no limitations. Suddenly they began to say, wait a minute, tell me more about this limitless living that you're talking about. We sat for hours on the floor, the second floor up there, as they took a break from painting. We gathered around and began to talk about this God that is a power within that brings about an amazing unfolding of goodness. Lights began to go on. Said, you know what? I can agree with that. I understand. And this is exactly what Jesus was trying to tell you. That there's more than just this physical world. There's a spiritual power that enables us to be overcomers. That enables us to walk and live high above the realm of this physical plane. To live in a consciousness and awareness of God's goodness ever desiring to unfold. Now, Jesus, as he entered into Jerusalem, he made an entrance that was very unique. Unique in this context. Because he entered in this way, and this is what he wanted to teach. He came in a path of least resistance. Now you see, wait a minute. There were all kinds of enemies around, gathering around. Wait till Jesus comes into Jerusalem. Now this will be our time to get him. You can imagine all of the energy gathering around him, of consciousness of people thinking, this is our time to really capture Jesus and let's see that his teaching is put to an end. But Jesus didn't respond to that in any way. It was a path of non-resistance, least resistance. This was his unique path. And it's a pathway for our personal success too. That we walk through life with a pathway of least resistance. Not responding to their evil desires, not responding to their evil ways, but moving forward. In this way, it's a way of removing barriers and walls and those things that may be presented to us in the physical realm, but we just dismiss them. We let them go by not responding. This is what's really called living the fluid life. Living the fluid life. Getting the fluidity to just move around. When there's obstacles that come into our way, we just move through them. Our faith, our power of believing says, I don't care if the wall comes up and says it's impossible. I move around that. I flow around it like water moving over rocks or obstacles in its pathway. It's a fluid life that we're called to live. This is what Jesus was demonstrating. As he taught about turn the other cheek, allow things to pass you by. When someone hits you on the cheek or tries to create some sort of evil context in your world, in your way, says something hurtful to you, you turn the other cheek almost as if to say, I just let it go by. I let it pass by. Certainly in the same context, when they ask you to do something, maybe your enemy asks you to do something. He used the illustration of the Roman occupation of the time. And he said, when they ask you to carry a bag, and you do it for me and say, I'm going to make you my servant. You Jewish people who are now in power over, you carry my bag for me 1 mile. And a Roman citizen or soldier may do that to someone. You say, not 1 mile. How about two? How about three? How about I go the extra mile with you, the extra journey? Now, how intimidating that was. Wait. I was just trying to make your life miserable. Instead, what you're doing is making my life easy and comfortable. I don't know how to respond to that. You see the big change. That fluid life that says there's no barriers. It's so disarming. It's breaking down walls. It's a life that allows all things to flow with no resistance. It's resistance, let me tell you, that opens the doors for anger, pain, and unforgiveness in our lives. Wow. When we put up some sort of wall, some sort of barrier to someone coming against us, it just opens the door for the seeds of anger to rise within us. Because we're responding to it. It's like when evil comes against us, we somehow respond to it, we acknowledge it, we embrace it then. We let it come into our lives. I'm from Minnesota, from those years gone by, my pastoral work up there. A lot of times people have a snowball fight. But let me tell you this, if you try to catch a snowball, you're engaged. I mean it, you know what I mean? Someone throws a snowball at you, you try to catch that snowball, you try to grab it, suddenly now you got to do it right back. And suddenly before it's tit for tat, it becomes a snowball fight that goes on and on and on in life. So it is in our life when we put up this sort of resistance. Someone comes against us and says something hurtful, harmful, evil comes against us. What we do is we reach out and grab it, we catch it. Oh, now suddenly we're engaged. Oh, now all of a sudden we've opened the door for the anger, for the pain, for these things that come against us that create this spirit of unforgiveness. Now, like, ooh, how dare you? I'll never let this go. Ooh, I'm going to get back at you. You see how it is? We've opened up the door for something in our lives. And this evil, what it really wants, is engagement. Anything that comes against you, it wants you to get engaged. You know how someone taunts you and taunts you and taunts you, wants you to respond back? And though you may try to keep a zip lid, suddenly you let it go. Ooh, you got engaged in the fight. You responded back. Someone said something hurtful to you, and dagnabbit, you said something back. And before you know it, they said something back. And you go, well, dagnabbit, I'm not going to let you have the last word. I'm going to have the last word. And here you go. And before you know it, it's tit for tat all over again. Evil simply wants engagement. And when we come to this place, where we're engaging, welcoming it. What we're doing is reaching out and allowing it to have a place in our lives. You see, the example of Jesus was a pathway of non-resistance, no resistance, the least resistance of anything in life. Saying, there may be evil, there may be that energy that's coming against me, there may be this opposition, but I take no part of it. I don't engage in it whatsoever. I allow it to flow on, for I'm living the fluid life. That's what it's all about. He knew of this opposition, and he did not let it become a barrier to his purpose and his calling. And how true this is in our life. This is how you make an entrance. You walk in and you don't let anything be a barrier to your purpose and your calling. Because you were meant to be the light of the world. And suddenly when you engage in evil in that darkness, it's crying out for that engagement. Your light is diminished. And though you desire to be this brilliant beacon, suddenly you've now moved to a place where you're no longer shining bright. You lost your purpose. You forgot your calling. So the question this scripture verse is asking us is, what do we do when we face these opposing forces? We face obstacles in our life. What do we do when there's things that we desire in our life, but there's walls or barriers to them? Is there resistance, or is there a path of non-resistance? Because so often we let things become this barrier, and we allow walls to spring up and roadblocks to rise. And it's time for us to stop setting roadblocks, and stop building walls, and to stop creating barriers in the journey to our great success and our spiritual fulfillment. Because let me tell you this, you have a purpose, you have a calling. We here are called City of Light, not because we thought it was a cute name, but because it really describes our purpose and our calling. That word light means truth, understanding. That word light is a synonym for God. That word light is the very essence of the Christ. So you might call yourself City of God, City of Christ, City of Truth, City of Understanding. All of those things, those terms, really embrace exactly what we're describing as our calling and our vision, our purpose. And we want nothing to diminish that. For as a city, a collective body, a group of diversity, an inclusive environment, a place that's welcoming everyone, sort of like the urban environments that cities are, where there's all kinds of exchange and opportunity. As we become that, it is our desire in that context to be an illuminating force, to help people understand who've been living in a world of darkness, the darkness of the fears of their life, the darkness of their questions, the darkness of their wondering, the darkness of their hopelessness, the darkness of their limitations. We're shining a light on that. And we want nothing, no barrier, no wall, no obstacle in any way to stand before us fulfilling our purpose. Amen? And each one wants that for yourself too, don't you? So we make an entrance into life. We make this daily entrance into our world when we tear down these walls, when we create a pathway of least resistance. And you may say, walls? Walls? Maybe you say, I don't have any walls. What are you talking about? Oh, we have many walls. We have walls of resistance that comes in many shapes and colors. They're barriers to the unfolding of the desires of your heart and your fulfillment of your calling. There are these obstacles in our pathway. And here's one. Let's talk about this that is a big one within our lives. A big wall, a big barrier. Ever hear of this structure? That structure determines behavior? It's an architectural thing. I had a great conversation with the architect Kyle Epstein, who's creating our amazing space in our new building. We talked about flow within the building. And how walls, you know, can create some barriers to the desires of what you want. I said, oh, I know what that's like. You know, you're in the kitchen, and there's a wall between you and the den, and you're trying out to reach to your partner and said, Robert, would you come here? And, of course, he can't hear because of the walls, or he can't hear because it's a selective hearing. I didn't hear you. There's a wall in the way, you know. No, would you come help me? Would you come help me? I can't hear you. There's a big barrier. There's a big wall, you know. Well, these walls, these structures, become barriers or obstacles to our behavior. The layout of your house, in today's world, a lot of young people are saying, I want an open concept. Open concept. You know, I want the living room, the dining room, the kitchen, everything to be all open. And if I'm in one room, I can see what's going on in the other, and there's absolutely no obstacles whatsoever. But in the older homes, we have a lot of divided rooms. And in a house with many little rooms, the layout of the house kind of determines then how you behave. Because you may have to leave one room to go into the other. You may not be able to see what's going on. You can't watch TV in the den when you're in the kitchen because there's a wall in the way. See, walls between us create this sort of conflict. Just as the wall between your desire and your belief is there as a barrier. God says, I want to be healed. How's that? I want to be healed. That's my desire. I really want to experience healing within my life. And your belief says, I know that Scripture says I can be healed. And Jesus was a healer. And the power and presence of God or the healing work. Okay, we have our desire and our belief. But we have this crazy wall, boom, that comes up between those two. You know what that wall is? The wall of, how's this gonna happen? How's this gonna happen? Now, we have lots of desires and we have lots of beliefs. We are Christians, we've read the Scriptures, we claim this, we form our beliefs on the very power and presence of God unfolding good. We keep saying all things are possible. With God, all things are possible. It is the Christ that strengthens me. I am enabled to do amazing things, and we claim this over and over again. And we have desires for amazing things. We have desires for prosperity and blessings in our lives. Oh, but there's that structural barrier that we put up that says, how's this going to happen? Really? How am I going to be healed? You know? How am I going to be blessed? How's prosperity going to be coming into my life? You see, that wall comes in there as the wall of a how. And often the wall of a how determines our behavior that you never act or clearly focus on what you really want. Because the how keeps saying, I got to figure out the how. I got to figure out how it's going to happen in my life. I want to know how this is going to unfold. And then we created this barrier that then it separates your desire from your belief. And the two of them are pushed further and further away as if the wall is ever expanding. In some of our lives, it's as big as the Great Wall of China. Because all we can think of is that how says it ain't going to happen. It's not possible. I can't see the how. I can't understand the how. It doesn't make sense. I keep looking in the physical realm, and there's nothing physical of this world that says it's really even going to be possible for me. So what happens is it drains out all the passion. It pulls out all the fire of our belief. And it gets us to regulate things again to that, well, maybe it will happen at another time, but not really now because I can't see the how. And that wall, it becomes an obstacle. You want to live a certain way, you have to decide what it is you want. And you have to be proactive with that. You don't let life decide for you. So no matter what the how is, you've got to tear that down, that wall, that barrier. So let's remove it. Let's do a little renovations in our spiritual life and in our consciousness. Because the how is up to God. It's not up to you. Yours is the journey of believing. Yours is the journey of setting the desire. But quite often we want to say, no, I'll leave the bleeding up to God. I'll leave the desires up to God. We keep saying, God, what is your will? Because I don't have anything to say about it. I don't even have any intentions or desires. I want to know what your will is, God. So I'm leaving the desires up to you. But I'm going to fuss and mess with the how. I'm going to sit down with a piece of paper and pen and write, how can I make this happen? How is this going to work out? I'm working in the how. And I look at the bottom line, and it's not going to work. So I'm giving up on my belief. I don't think it's going to work. I'm going to tell you this. That's why it's called miraculous. And that's why we're called to live in the miraculous. And that's why the spiritual world has nothing to do with the physical. So I got to tell you this. I've been your pastor for 16 years. And on paper, this church doesn't work. I have had so many people tell me the church is going to fold. You're going to go bankrupt. I think my first 6 months here, I had a board member tell me 16 years ago, there's not enough money to make things go. This place will fold. We've been here 16 years. Why? Because we live in the spirit. This is the big difference that Jesus was teaching. Yet that's why the world said we want to get rid of this crazy idea that manifesting miracles is the way of your everyday living. No way! We don't want people creating miracles. We want you to continue to live in fear. We want you to be in doubt. We want you held captive in limitation. We want you to believe that it's impossible. We would love it if you'd fold up and then we'll just take control. You see how the world is? So when you set your primary desire and you want to be proactive about it, you don't let life decide for you. You begin to claim, these are my desires of my heart. How about this? You say, I want a job. I'm looking for a job. How wonderful. But first, I think I'll go shopping. And, I want a job, but first I'm going to go shopping. And then, you know what? I really would like to have a job. I'm going to look for a job. But you know what? I'm going to have lunch with my friends. I decided, let's have lunch instead. I'm going to have a job. And you know what? I'm looking for a job, and dagnabbit, let's go on vacation. I think I'm going to be gone for the week, and I'm going to go home, go on vacation, and I'm looking for a job. Like, really? You're looking for a job? On vacation? Shopping? Lunch? Okay. You see how it is when we say that we're looking for something? And we say it, but we're not making it our number one priority of our life. We're not putting it first. We're not being proactive. You know why we procrastinate things? It's because we're afraid. We're scared. And we don't know how. And that's where our fear is. I want a job, but I don't know how I'm going to get it. Again, we built the wall of the how, didn't we? We just put up that barrier. I want a job. I just don't know how it's going to happen for me. Bam, the wall's up. You may say, I want to be blessed, and I know God's blessing is there for me. I don't know how. Everything that we climb in, so we sit, we say, let's just go shopping, let's have lunch, let's go on vacation. It's so much easier that way because I can't figure out the how. And you know, let me tell you this, Jesus is trying to teach us, would you leave the how up to the divine? Because it's not yours to be concerned with. When you tear that wall down, that's the miraculous, because all through the scripture after scripture, lesson after lesson has been trying to tell you this, that the children of Israel didn't know how the waters were going to part, but they stepped in waters and they parted. Daniel didn't understand how he would be protected in the lion's den when there's hungry beasts all around him, but he was in the lion's den knowing that he'd be taken care of. Every single story in the Bible is trying to tell you, would you let go of the how and get back trusting. Claiming your desires and knowing what you want. Because when you do, that's how you make an entrance. You walk in. I know my purpose. I know my calling. That's how you walk in. Doesn't matter what's happening around you. Doesn't matter about the opposition. Doesn't matter that the crowds may be saying you're going to fail. Doesn't matter that everybody says it's not possible. Doesn't matter that we're out to get you. Doesn't matter. Jesus demonstrated for us. That's how you make an entrance. This is how it's done. Because let me tell you this. Have you ever, spun around in a circle a bunch of times? You know, maybe been on a merry-go-round. Maybe you've just been spinning and spinning and spinning. Maybe you have too much to drink and you're spinning. You lose your balance. You know how it is? You're looking for something and the world is turning up and down and all this, but suddenly, you know what the secret is? If you just focus on your fingertip, you'll regain your balance. If you just refocus on one thing in a world that wants to create a spinning environment for you, bam, you'll come back to purpose and calling. Focus on that. And when you do, no matter what the world environment is around you, no matter how much it's coming back to you, that setbacks may come and they make you dizzy as you're spinning around, when you go back to, wait a minute, what is my purpose? My purpose here is to be the light for the world. How? Is up to God. My purpose, I'm walking, I'm making an entrance. I'm going to work today saying I'm going to be a light for the world. I'm going home today saying I'm a light for the world. I'm going to have lunch today with people saying I'm a light for the world. You see, I know my purpose. How that happens? Well, that's up to God. That's up to the divine unfolding of goodness at work within me. You see, Jesus understood this, and in his entrance, he knew what he wanted. Even though the world may not understand, he knew what he wanted in his purpose, was to demonstrate that calling. He does it in such a wonderful way that he actually beats those opposition at their game. Because you know what? He walks in humility, humbleness, not in arrogance. You know, Jesus could have been very defiant. I'll show you. I'll teach you a lesson. You cross my path. He could have been very aggressive and say, I tell you what, let's not march in with one donkey. Let's get 100 and let's march in. Let's show them. Let's make big fanfare. Let's make this a big deal and show them how dare them trying to take my teaching down. How dare them say that what I have to say is not of value. I'll show them with my arrogant approach. He could have been on the attack. How about we protest? How about we send a big march ahead of us? We'll have big banners and big signs that say, you know, stop the Pharisees, stop those who oppose us, stop those who are really getting in the way, stop the Romans. We could do all this kind of stuff. Came in humility, humbled attitude. Instead, he won people over with his message of peace and this example of least resistance that says, I don't care what's going on in the world. I know what I'm here to do. For what we persist in recognizing, we will persist in holding in place. I'm going to say that again. What we persist in recognizing, like I persist in recognizing evil, harm, people attacking me, opposition. I'm focusing on it. I'm thinking, you're out to get me. You're out to get me. You're against me. Oh, this is hard to do. This is difficult. This is going to be a hardship in my life. And all this, every time you keep focusing on it, you hold it in place. You know that? But when you release it and pay no attention, it goes away. Why? Because we erase the idea of failure in this. We refuse to recognize and we neutralize it, for it has no longer a power or presence in our lives. And suddenly what happens is we move into the realm of no failure. No failure. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Wait a minute. You mean we could live in an idea and a thought that there's no failure? I kind of think that there's failures. I've had failures. I'm comfortable with failures. I'm used to failing. I'm not used to winning or being successful. So, you know, let me be more comfortable with that. And you see, that's the problem with our spiritual life, because we've lost sight of the fact that the Spirit never fails. God never fails. When we understand that, that's living the life that we're called to live. But we kind of like failures. We kind of like things. Well, you know, there's a lot of opposition out there. There's a lot of problems. There's a lot of things to come against. There's a lot of evil. It just may win. You're right. You hold it in your consciousness. You keep claiming that. And so it will. But as we neutralize it, as we pay no attention to it, as we move on, we move into this realm, and we affirm that the Spirit never fails as every day part of our living, that this word blocks out your mind any sense of lack or limitation or fear of failure, that the Spirit of God is going before we, always making a way when there seems to be no way. There is no failure then, and no person can fail you, because when we are walking with God, it's impossible to fail. Failure is neither a person nor a place or a thing. What it is a false thought. That's exactly what it is. And you put power into that false thought. God didn't say, okay, I created you to come into this world to fail. And I hope you do. There's no scripture you can't find a single one like that. You know that? Yet we'd love to claim it. Sometimes we believe it and say, well, that's my Bible. That's exactly what I believe. Because boy, oh boy, my life has been one failure after another. And let me tell you this. It's just a false thought. Because God didn't call you to a spirit of failure, to lack or limitation. God's called you to an abundant life. Jesus said, I came that you might have life abundant. Abundant. Do we get that? That's what it's all about. God is the God of how and the very master of creating. And that abundance that we call forth is that which comes from this wonderful awareness of God. And when we enter into our daily life with this purpose and understanding, just as Jesus did, the world will cry out, blessed is he or she who comes in this character, who comes in this name, the very name and essence of the Lord. Because that's what the name means. The name means the very character of the one. When you walk into a room, you make an entrance and someone says, ooh, blessed, meaning happy. Happy is this person. Happy is Crystal. She just walked into the room today knowing her purpose, knowing that no obstacles, nothing against her, there is no opposition, because she cannot fail today. She knows the power of God is at work within her, and she's called to live out her purpose. Suddenly, the world will respond with the wonderful joys. Blessed, happy are you. I see it. I see something amazing in your life. I see something wonderful in your life. That's how you make an entrance. And that's how we do it like Jesus. Because he came to this world in such a way to say, I want every action, every essence of my life to show you the way. The way to the very power of being successful in your life. Today, Palm Sunday is more than just waving palms or throwing down coats in the pathway of Jesus. It's a beautiful lesson for us of how we walk into the world every day as a triumphant entrance. Every day, we live it as we live the path of least resistance. Amen.